Recording. And here we go. Hello, everybody. Welcome to the SummitBid podcast.
SummitBid podcast.
We are officially renaming it. We've been exposure compensation, and now we are the SummitBid podcast, and the whole feed and everything. That's just kind of the name that we're kind of going with from now on. So yeah. It just makes sense, right?
It does. And it's, you know, we wanted to still offer the photo news stuff we've been doing for a long time, but then also expanded into some of the other stuff we do,
like right,
the outdoors, yeah. The mountain trips, the gallery, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah. And you know, just kind of eventually just kind of talk about, you know, what we do, because we do a lot of different things. So, so let's talk a little bit about the format here. This is going to be for, if you're watching this on YouTube, this is going to be very audio focused. So go ahead and minimize your browser. Like, unless you want to look at our lovely faces the whole time, just go ahead and minimize your browser. Like this is basically a podcast. You can also, if you want to just have us in your podcast feed, you can search the SummitBid podcast, and we're going to be available. And for a little while longer, you can catch up on our old show, Exposure Compensation, although I think I'll probably take that down in about a month or so. But you can listen to those old episodes. So
yeah, you can catch up with the old podcast. But I think that this new one will be good. So today, it looks like we're going to be, we did want to talk about the different places. It's any podcasting app you use will also be on Spotify as well.
Yeah.
And of course, iTunes.
Yeah, iTunes, YouTube, Spotify. If you're on YouTube, you'll see obviously all of our videos. So we would love it if you would subscribe there. But if you want to just listen to this podcast, it's on iTunes, Spotify, pretty much anywhere you're going to get podcasts from. So.
All right. So today, it looks like we have a couple subjects to go over. We will be talking about Nikon's new cameras, but I think first, we're going to talk about some of the rumors blowing around about 2021 Pro cameras.
Right, because finally, it seems like we're going to be getting these really, really Pro cameras. I mean, you could say the A9 and A9II are. They've had their limitations, but I think that in 2021, we're going to get some real interesting cameras from, and we have solid rumors from Sony, Nikon, and Canon. So we're going to kind of go in that order and just run down, and then what we think, and and kind of talk about these new cameras. Like, is this something we're going to be interested in, and like what does it do to the camera landscape?
Yeah, for
in
sure.
2021, because the landscape's changed so much in 2020.
Yeah, for sure. Well, I mean, Canon basically came back this year.
Right. came from nowhere.
That's cool. And we'll, of course, talk about that a little bit more, probably some other time. But I think that one question about Sony is, do we think they're going to, is it going to be the A9III? Is it that continuation? They're just raising the price point and raising the functionality. Because when you look at what the A9 series has been already, it's mostly a professional wildlife sports camera.
Right.
It's capable for video, but about as capable to maybe a little less than like its $2,000, you know, little brother, A7 III or,
there's
R4.
It has no log profiles, which is, that's always been fascinating. Sony has actually come out and said that they can't figure out how to do it with that back sensor. So anyway, well, let's run over the rumored specs of this Sony Pro camera, A9III, A10, A12, like who knows?
A11 probably.
A11, there you go. It's supposed to have around a 50 megapixel sensor. It's going to shoot 8K 30 with no overheating. Other specs are similar to the A7S III. The EVF is going to be that 9.whatever million dot EVF. The autofocus is going to be similar to that. And then the real kicker is that it's supposed to be at least $1,500 more expensive than the R5, so $1,000 more than the A9II, and but it could be as high as $5,500.
Oh, wow.
So that's what they're saying. Which, now, granted, 5500 is less than the 1DX Mark III and the D6 by Nikon. So, you know, you're still down below that number. So
it's interesting to me that the rumored, I don't know what this means necessarily, but it's interesting to me that the rumor's 8K 30p, it's not 4K 120 or anything, like, it's not high frame rate, it's high resolution.
Right, right.
So I mean, that's interesting, and 50 megapixels is more than you need for 8K. So from a videographer's perspective, that's interesting.
Right.
The no overheating thing, I think I'll believe it when I see it come out. I don't know when we're really going to get to that point where 8K is overheating free. Maybe this is that camera. But honestly, I think there's also an argument of, I don't even know why you'd want no overheating for 8K, because it would take so much memory up.
Right. Point. Yeah, exactly. I think it's more just to say, say it doesn't overheat, because that's been such the news spin. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, my instinct is that this is going to be the A9III. Mm-hmm. I think that we're going to see a whole body redesign. Like, I mean, how can you fit a heat sink that's going to be able to do 8K 30?
Do you think gripped?
I think gripped. I think actually all three of these cameras are going to be gripped. I think we're finally going to see our built-in gripped mirrorless cameras. I think we kind of have to, right? Because, like, certainly they're looking at Canon and with the R5 and the heating issues and the processors and all that stuff, they're going to have to fit in these things. Dual XQD card slot, not XQD card, CF Express, right? I mean, I'm sure that this new Sony one's going to use that type A, which is the smaller one, right, that the S3 uses. But
I think it'll be hybrid, where you can put both SD cards and the new one in.
I don't know. I mean, maybe. I mean, I think that why would you do that on a $5,500 camera? Just, you know, people need to buy CF Express cards if you're
Yeah, I mean, I guess that's true, but also I suppose if you really needed to buy the like a ton of media for something you're doing and you didn't need the speed.
Yeah, I guess that's a good point. Yeah.
It's easier to get a terabyte SD card.
Right.
But yeah.
So, let's just, so that we can do the spec comparison, let's just go ahead and hit Nikon's, which is, it does have a rumored name, which is the Z9. Which is hilarious that it's the Z9 and they're going right after the A9.
Oh yeah, they've been going right after Sony this whole time with their mirrorless stuff.
Yeah, so I'll just run down this real quick. The Z9 is described as a D6 body combined with an R5 imaging, A9II AF, and blackout-free EVF. By the way, these specs are courtesy of Sony Alpha Rumors, Nikon Rumors, and CanonRumors.com. So that's where we kind of get these, and we kind of watch those websites quite a bit. The Z9 is supposed to have a 46-megapixel sensor, 20 frames per second, 8K 30, 4K 120, 60, and 30. So more detailed video specs there. A new EXPEED processor designed for 8K, improved AF, object detection AF, two XQD CF Express Type B card slots, both so that bigger card slot, ISO 64 to 25600, high resolution, blackout-free EVF, new user interface, no second LCD screen, like on the D6. A brand new battery. They even have a part number, ENEL18X. Gigabit LAN, USB-C, Wi-Fi, GPS, and price between $6,000 and $7,000. So a lot more detailed specs on this Nikon Z9. I mean, and it kind of sounds amazing.
Yeah, no, it does sound amazing. It does seem like the R5 opened Pandora's box with the 8K thing. Like all of these, they're like Sony's being like, at least the rumors saying no overheating, and then over here there's a line that says designed for 8K recording.
Right,
doesn't
exactly.
Doesn't say no overheating, but that's interesting from a video perspective. And it's also interesting that we'll get to the Canon specs in a second, but this is the most fully realized spec list of the three.
Right.
So I wonder if we'll see that one come out first, or it's just...
Well, and actually, it's both the Canon and Nikon are rumored for second half of 2021, so kind of July on. The Sony there's not a lot of people are hoping for January. I think they're all going to be close together. They're going to play the game of they're all going to release as close together as they possibly can, just because, like, you know, Sony gives Canon and Nikon a chance to one up them, or if they release early. But at the same time, like, they're, you know, people will migrate to Sony over this A9III or whatever it's going to be called, because it's going to be an amazing camera. So, you know, I think that they probably all want to be first, although the Canon R5 and the Sony A7S III are an example of why you don't always want to be first, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure, with the overheating scandal that maybe... I mean, I think the S3 would have been fine anyway, but I think a lot of people bought it just because they were like, oh, it doesn't
overheat. Right. It's reliable. Yeah. If that camera comes out first, it maybe doesn't get all the praise that it got.
Yeah. Have to go, like, people aren't going to make second videos on it. And now the entire narrative about the S3 is based off of the R5. Whereas if it had come out first, the entire narrative would have been, oh, this camera's cool, but the R5 shoots 8K. If it hadn't been confirmed that it had overheating issues. Now, to be fair to the R5, I've shot with it on two professional video shoots, for separate clients, and had no problems. Right. One of which I used 4K 60 for about 2 hours, 4K 120 for about 2 hours.
Oh, wow. Really? For 2 hours?
Obviously off and on. Like, I was turning the camera off, turning it back on again. And it was with a coffee shop, so he had to make drinks for someone, so I was able to turn it off.
Oh, okay, cool.
And you have it. It was actually his R5.
Right, yeah. It's actually the R5 filming us right now.
And you have it up to date, right?
Yes, I do have it up to date to the latest firmware. I didn't realize that you shot for 2 hours in 4K 120. Did the overheating warning ever come up? It never even came up.
So I think that something that... This is oftentimes something that I've understood, and these cameras, I bet none of them will have record limits, although Nikon, I'm not sure if Nikon still does that or not.
Right.
But the thing about recording for, like, long periods of time is it's something you either need or you don't. And, you know, in that situation, the chances that I'm going to shoot 40 minutes of anything, especially continuous in that situation, it's basically zero. if I'm shooting an event that is 40 minutes long or 50 minutes long, then it's guaranteed I'm going to shoot for that long. Now, the question you have to start kind of working into that with all of these cameras, if they do overheat, you know, they're professional cameras.
Right,
and
right.
The Canon and the Nikon say nothing about no overheating. And there's a part of me that feels like that's kind of somebody at the Sony rumor sounds a little...
Well, the Sony Alpha Rumors guy, he tends to get a little, excited. Yes. Mm-hmm. We'll put it that way. He gets excited about the new cameras, and, they sometimes get a little, the rumors get a little jazzed up, I feel like.
Indeed.
Whereas the Nikon and Canon rumors guy, particularly the Canon rumors guy, like, he does not post stuff on there that he's not fairly confident about. So, he usually doesn't offer opinion either. Mm-hmm. Whereas the Sony Alpha Rumors guy definitely does. Mm-hmm. Granted, Sony Alpha Rumors is a much bigger site than either Nikon or Canon. Like, it's a huge site. Mm-hmm. So very, very popular.
Indeed.
So, before we move on to the Canon specs, is there any, like, Nikon specific things that jump out to you here?
Well, the previous rumor suggested 60 megapixel sensor is interesting.
Yes. And then they dropped it down to 46. I think we can all agree that between 40 and 50 is the new standard megapixel. It seems like for a, For, I mean, almost any camera, I think, I think we're going to see consumer cameras more consumer oriented, because almost any camera that's not a cell phone now is a somewhat professional camera. Right. Mm-hmm. So, but I think a consumer, more consumer oriented camera, I think we're going to, they're going to stay down a little lower just because the file sizes, but I think any camera that's going to be geared towards a professional application is just like, it's just, that's where we're at, is it's being between 40 and a 50 megapixels.
And I think it's that really nice middle area of a little too much resolution. You have that little bit over the top so that you're not going to run into like pixelization in prints, or, you know, you have a little bit more cropping to work with. Stuff like that.
Yeah. Well, and then
correction without losing it.
But right. Exactly.
You don't have just like a giant 60 or 100 megapixel file.
Well, and I think something in all of these cameras is that you're going to be able to drop the megapixels. So like, why? I mean, like, it works well. Like look at like the D850 does it well. Like those downsample files, I've seen, you know, examples of them, and they're great.
And you shot with the D850.
Yeah, I shot with the D850 for a while, and it was they were great. Mm-hmm. I think with all these cameras, you're going to be able to set your megapixels in it. So why not have it be a higher resolution so that option's there for you? Mm-hmm. And the camera's tuned to that. So like, but if you need to drop down to 24 megapixels, like do it, like no problem. Right.
Well, I think it's time to, increase the megapixels on these pro bodies because, you know, this is not very often that I feel like you actually see issues with resolution and an image and very many images. But, when you see 20 megapixel giant prints that are 20 megapixels, sometimes they look pretty good.
Right.
But when you compare them to 40 to 50 megapixel prints, especially when they're 30 by 60 or larger,
right.
You're going to run into that little edge of sharpness just kind of falls off a little bit.
Yeah.
And then the other area is, do you remember that Canon Explorer of Light? I can't remember what it was called. It was,
on that Netflix show.
That Netflix show.
Something with the light, but it was like not overtly
tales by light.
There we go. Check it out on Netflix. It's very cool. It's not overtly sponsored by Canon, but it's sponsored by Canon.
There's one Nikon shooter in the whole thing. Maybe it's not sponsored by Canon. It's just that many professional photographers use Canon.
Yikes.
Ouch. You know, in that you would notice a lot of the photos were breathtaking photos they were taking.
Right.
But they were kind of noisy and sometimes not the absolute sharpest thing in the universe. Right.
They were all using 1DXs and occasionally a 5D Mark IV.
I saw 5DSRs a couple times, which of course was super better. High res for a long time.
But it was all 1DXs, really. Yeah. Like it was vast majority.
And I understand that decision by somebody if I'm going to go to the Himalayas and I need the camera to work both, you know, with me, be easy to use in all situations and stuff. I understand why they made that decision, but I think that it's time for that upgrade. And I think that we are getting to the point where there's enough storage. Storage is cheap enough. SD cards are cheap enough that it's reasonable as long as they can get that high speed for performance, which is why I wonder if the A9 will stick around. There may be a sports,
an application for it.
Sports professional camera slot. And I don't know for sure if that's true or not, but the A9's feeling that it's a little bit cheaper because it doesn't have to support the video specs. Because what these feel like to me is they're do everything cameras. They're not one-trick ponies. And the only camera that I feel like has been getting closer to that is Canon getting closer and closer with the 1DX1, which had 4K for the first time and a decent-ish resolution. And then the 1DX2 and then the 1DX3, they're getting more and more of that multi use case camera. They're working a lot of video specs in. And then the big thing that's missing is that high resolution. So you have the speed, you have the video, which were, you know, probably kind of easy to match because you already have that lower res
sensor
to help with the video side. And I think that these are that, okay, now you want to know what landscape photographers want this too. And wildlife photographers want to be able to crop more. So they want higher resolution. It just, it makes sense. If I've been shooting for a decade with, if I've been shooting with a decade for 20, with 20 megapixels, I would want that upgrade eventually.
Right. Yeah. Around. I mean, no joke. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, actually let's run through the Canon specs real quick. It's got an all-new image sensor with a global shutter. So this is the first real big difference than the other two. It's got a groundbreaking new autofocus system. The rumor is that it's quad pixel, and there's actually a patent for quad pixel autofocus, and we can talk about that more in a second, what that actually looks like. Fastest frame rate for stills camera ever from Canon. Second half of 2021 announcement. So we have the least amount of specs, but they're kind of the most wild, like kind of on par with kind of how Canon has been over the last year, because these are a global shutter is wild.
Yeah. It's a huge deal for people out there who maybe are like, what does global shutter, why would that be important? The A9 has that super fast backed sensor.
Right.
And that's really cool. And it's allowed it to have that, silent shooting. That works very
well. It reads out the image really fast.
It reads out the image really fast. With the global shutter, and this is what a lot of people pay tens of thousands of dollars for in those cinema cameras, that it's that little spec that a lot of people don't pay attention to. Mm-hmm. They're like, oh, red cameras shoot 8K, that's so cool. But they also have, I believe, at least some of them have global shutters, and that means every pixel on the sensor is recorded at the same time, the exact same moment. So banding gone,
right?
Rolling shutter gone in stills and in video, and those two things they sound, you know, maybe like not that important, but coming from the A6600, the camera I've been using for a long time, and Sony cameras in general, from a video shooter's perspective, it really can make your footage look bad. Even if it's sharp, even if it's great, it makes shake kind of sickening. It's like jello effect. If you've done much research on YouTube, you've probably heard people talk about, you know, lines not being straight and stuff.
Right.
And for stills, it's maybe even a bigger deal because it can be completely silent in all situations.
In all situations, and you're never going to get that banding, you're never going to get that warping. Like the A9 doesn't do it much, but it still does it like occasionally. And so that's a huge deal. And then the quad pixel autofocus is also a huge deal. From what I understand about how dual pixel autofocus works is it kind of works, it finds the contrast horizontally but not vertically. So by adding the quad, you're going to be doing horizontal and vertical. So it's literally going to be twice as good as dual pixel, which is dual pixel has been the gold standard. Canon really squandered dual pixel because they had the best mirrorless autofocus system before they were doing anything with mirrorless, because they released it on the 70D, right? Wasn't it 70D? And then it was in the 5D Mark IV and
the 1DX2.
The 1DX2, 1DX3. And but it was like, it has taken Sony so long to get their video autofocus close. And a lot of people still say it's just close. A lot of people say it's better. Some people say it's, you know, the same. But, you know, it's still an argument. And it's that came out, the 70D was like, what, 2014, 2015?
It may have been 2013.
Yeah, I mean, you know what? Let's do a quick little Google search, because I'm actually really curious.
See how long it's been the king.
Canon 70D.
This is the Casey Neistat camera.
This is the Casey Neistat camera.
It's the one that started the vlogging craze.
People are still buying it. There's the Wikipedia. Oh, wow. 2013.
So that's
2013.
It came out alongside the A6000 in that case.
Wow.
So that's impressive considering where the autofocus was from Sony, and Sony made leaps and bounds. I've used, once again, the stills autofocus. I have a hard time. I mean, the only stills I take are like landscapes. So I don't know about stills autofocus. Kemper can say more about that. But from a video perspective, it's very good, but it's not as controllable. Mm-hmm. It doesn't feel as controllable. Mm-hmm. And a lot of that's the interface. It's the touchscreen, mm-hmm. which is a huge thing that Canon has over, well, Canon and Nikon and Panasonic have over Sony is their touchscreen interface.
Right.
And there's some definite like learning curves. Like they feel different. They work differently. Mm-hmm. But the ability to touch on the screen, and it will at least do something, you know, when you touch on the screen.
Right. Right.
And that's, I really appreciate that from, you know, from Canons, and I'm using the EOS R, so I'm not even using the newest of the new.
Right. The newest of the new. Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, these are all wild. Like, I think that like with Canon, like to kind of fill in the blanks, I'm going to assume that this new sensor is 45 megapixels just because the other two are. I would be surprised if they would keep it at half the megapixels. I think a lot of pro shooters, but you know, Canon's still Canon. I think because we don't have that resolution. I have heard a rumor that there definitely is a resolution bump coming. It just may not be that high. I mean, I don't
30.
Know.
I could see it being 30.
I could see it being 32. Yeah. Would you trade, 30, the 45 megapixels for a global shutter?
Oh, well I would.
Because of the video.
I'm
yeah.
Not
yeah.
Gonna use it, but
yeah.
As a stills photographer, here's something I will say. I got the EOS R completely for video reasons and some, you know, some details I'll get into on a different day. But coming back with the 30 megapixel stills, and I've been shooting 20 to 24 for a very long time, five, 6 years since I had anything that was significantly below 20. Mm-hmm. And the difference is noticeable at that point. And that was kind of surprised how noticeable it was for the few shots that I took. It just felt
up to 30.
Really yeah. sharp and nice. So, you know, is it going to make a difference in your Instagram posts? Probably not, but neither right. will 30 to 45.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I guess that's so, true. Good point.
You know, you'll have more cropping ability. I think that there's a chance that it will be something random that's close to 45 though, because Canon's kind of traditionally done that in the past with like their 1DX having a 20 megapixel sensor and the 5D Mark III having 22. They usually don't have the same, and it doesn't mean if it's the same resolution, it's the same sensor, but I think Canon right. likes being like, oh, it's a little different, like tipping their hat.
Right.
Like maybe it's 47, maybe it's 40, but it's very close to be negligible, but a little different just so that there's
right.
differentiates the spec sheet. I'm not sure they're as into everything being uniform
right.
as Canon and excuse me, as Sony and
right.
Nikon sometimes are.
I also think that we can just assume that it's going to have 8K 30, 4K 120, all that.
I guess like, unless it's 20 megapixels.
All right. Well, yeah, if it is 20 megapixels, it's no 8K. I mean, that's no a good 8K. Point. Like it has to be, what is it, 42?
I think
something
it's
like that?
36.
Oh, is it 36? You can get away with it? Okay.
Maybe. Because like obviously 8K is everything from 8,000 pixels wide.
Right. And, yeah. Oh, okay. Right.
So
that makes sense.
It's just like 4K is everything from 4K to 5K, basically.
Right. That makes sense.
So there's a whole range that you can kind of, you can slip in that 8K number. Even sometimes if it's a little under, they'll still say 8K or 4K or
yeah.
whatever.
Yeah. Well, that's true 4K is not 4,000. Like
it's
UHD, Ultra HD, it's yeah. not actually 4K.
It's 3840.
It's 3848. Yeah.
3840.
Yeah. 3840. Sorry. So I think these cameras are all very interesting. I'm excited that finally that we're getting these true pro bodies. Like Sony's flirted with it with the A9, but finally, like you know, this is the DSLR era is over. Like this
yeah.
really is the signal that it's over.
Well, yeah, and I think that the. The other big thing about these cameras is you can see a little bit of the direction of the camera companies from what these are. Like, I'm not going to buy one of these cameras, I'm pretty sure.
Right. You're going to stay more video focused.
More video focused.
If you were going to drop this kind of money, you would get something like the C70. Mm-hmm.
C70, or I would drop double as much and buy a C300 or something.
Right.
Like, that's the direction that I would go in. I don't really need a lot more than the EOS R even for stills needs,
right,
or whatever.
Right, right, right.
But, you know, these are professional video-ish cameras. It's just they won't have that next level of just they'll never overheat no matter what, so you can do whatever you want with them. And the extra buttons and the onboard controls for audio and XLR mini or XLR full-sized inputs, stuff like that's really cool. But what you can see here is what you can expect from the camera companies a little bit, you know.
Right.
Oh, if Nikon opens the box to having 8K in their lineup and 4K and 4K 60 and 4K 30P, and maybe it has log in there as well,
mm-hmm.
you can start to get a feel for, okay, so this is what Nikon's future video is, and can I grow with that, or is that not good enough for me? And of course, the big problem with Nikon is it doesn't have any pro video bodies, but because they're kind of stepping into the video game. And the same thing's true with Sony, and just like little features and stuff, those will trickle down. So you can see, even if you're never going to buy these cameras, kind of the direction.
Right, exactly. That's a really good point. Like, the 1DX2 in its own way showed the direction that things were going. So, and then, you know, similar with Nikon and their D series. So it's probably time to move on to non-theoretical cameras, to two new-ish,
mm-hmm.
very ish,
indeed.
Cameras that Nikon announced, the Z6II and the Z7II. What do you, first off, just before we even get into anything here, what do you think about them dropping the S in favor of 2? Like, it just seems like the copying of Sony is like, it's almost blatant at this point. It's almost like a joke.
Yeah, it's... I don't know. They feel more like S's or like small bumps, not revolutions.
Mm-hmm.
Just off the spec sheet, I think it's you know, I guess it is what it kind of is, but they want to make it feel different with the naming scheme. That could be what they're going for.
Right, they're definitely patch cameras.
It just feels. Like you said, it feels like they're copying Sony, which isn't. Right. I don't think that's what Nikon wants. I mean, maybe that's what a Nikon shooter that's lusting after Sony wants them to do.
Yeah, exactly. Who doesn't feel like they can switch, or I don't know what.
Exactly.
I mean, their design, like, I feel like the Z cameras are better designed than the Sony cameras ergonomically and stuff like that. But they look like the A7s and the Nikons. I mean, they look so similar that...
They really do. Nikons feel better in the hand.
They do. They feel way better. So there's
that.
So, okay. So what is new? Well, they both have the same sensors, so that's not new. Mm-hmm. But they have dual EXPEED 6 processors now, so they've doubled the processing power, which is great.
Yeah.
They both shoot at higher frame rates now. The Z6II shoots at 14 frames a second, and the Z7II... is to 10 frames a second.
And that's just one more, though.
It really is. The Z7 was 9 frames a second, and the Z6 was 12. So this isn't a huge... Huge difference. But the big thing is that they have added a second SD card slot.
So they're XQD and SD now.
Yeah, that is. So they have two slots, which... really was the thing that derailed Nikon, the Nikon mirrorless. Like, if they had put two slots in the first time around, the conversation would have been so different.
Mm-hmm.
It just, like, that took over the photo news industry for about, I mean, it did to the, I feel like the R5 is overall weathering the overheating storm better than the Z6 and Z7 handled the single card slot storm.
Well, people, when they hear this isn't professional,
right,
like, it makes people who want to buy it feel like, oh well, I think I'm professional, so right.
I'm professional enough, or like, I want the professional gear.
That in a small way with the R5, that almost worked on me when the R5 was first announced, with like, oh well, I shoot professional video, so I'd never want to buy an R5. And then when you sit down and actually think about what you do, it's like, well, it would probably support my needs for the most part. And after actually using the camera, I'm more convinced now and you know, looking at that camera. And the point of bringing that up is to say that the Z6 and Z7 were not bad cameras,
no,
and
they
weren't unprofessional cameras either.
No, they weren't. And the XQD card format is so reliable. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, they probably, like, I don't know this for a fact, but they probably, their data scientists or whatever was like, the failure rate on an XQD card is similar enough to the failure rate on two SD cards, right? Mm-hmm. So they're like, you know, like, why put it in there? And it is, it's interesting, like, having the dual card slots. Like, I've been shooting for a long time with dual card slots ever since the 5D Mark IV. And I've never needed it. Knock on wood. Yeah, I've never needed that second slot. So, but you know, it's here now. So they can't be criticized. So another little things, tidbits about it. They now support a vertical battery grip, which is another thing that was hugely controversial for whatever reason. They had their buffer is significantly better. The Z6II is 124 shots and the Z7II is 50 shots. I don't remember exactly what the other ones were, but that's a lot better.
They're not here on there.
And page. The video specs. So here, this is very interesting. They added 4K 60p to both. But the Z7II gets it right away, and the Z6II gets it in February.
It gets it in a
firmware update in February.
Is it paid?
I don't know. I do not know the answer to that. What I think is funny is that the obvious, like, it's blatant that they're crippling the Z6II for a period of time. Mm-hmm. I don't know whether it is that they want to sell Z7IIs. Or what's going on there, mm-hmm. where they would need to do that?
Yeah, I have no clue. And now, correct me if I'm wrong, the Z7 and Z7II can both do the ProRes RAW thing out to a...
No. I think only the Z6 can. The Z7 can't at all.
Oh, interesting. I mean, I guess I thought I saw it on like the lineup of cameras, but I don't... that support it, but I suppose that's a
we'll have to,
different day.
Yeah, but
the reason why it's strange is the Z6 feels like more the videographer's camera.
Right.
I mean they put in stuff like full pixel readout. The 4K is probably slightly more detailed. And you know, the low light performance may be a little bit better. Who knows? Just because that lower resolution and downsampling from 6K to 4K, because it says it's full pixel readout on the Z6. So it's just strange to think like, okay, well, we want to sell more of the Z7II if that's what's going on here. And so we're going to keep 4K 60 out of the camera that's more built for video, kind of like the R3 and the A7III.
Right. Yeah. I mean, it's very, it's an interesting, I don't understand the game. If it's a game, I suppose that it could be just, they literally couldn't figure out how to get it in, but why would you do the specific firmware update for being, what is that? That's 6 months away. Is that 6 months?
Something like that.
Yeah, something like 6 months, yeah.
That's a long time, considering that's the main video upgrade you're getting.
Right.
Like, if you buy a Z6II, the main thing is the dual card slots, which is great.
Right.
That's cool. But that's, you know, that's kind of photo and video. Mm-hmm. But then it's 4K 60. That's the
right.
next thing.
And that's
then, and then the only other question that I have is when you compare it to its competition, they all shoot 4K 60 at this point, except Sony doesn't have one. Sony hasn't released the A7 IV yet.
Right.
But the R6 and the S1 and the S5,
right.
They're the closest competition to it, and they all shoot 4K 60 in some degree.
Right.
And with different trade-offs. You have the S5, which is probably the best 4K 60 camera right now.
Mm-hmm.
But I think, I might be wrong on this, so don't quote me, I think it still has the APS-C crop.
Oh, I think I heard that too.
And so does the S1.
Right.
And then the R6 has that feature where it has it in with like a 1.1 crop, like basically irrelevant crop, but it overheats pretty bad. And I've heard that with the firmware updates, you can kind of mixed shoot it without it really overheating, which makes sense because you're not going to shoot 40 minutes of slow motion at one time.
Right.
Necessarily. I mean, unless you want to output in 60p, in which case, you know, it wouldn't be slow motion. But I think that the real answer to this camera is the Z6II going to be competitive? Does it overheat in 4K 60? If it doesn't overheat at all, that's a big leg up over what Sony has right now, what Canon has right now,
right,
and what Panasonic's offering, because it's apparently full frame. It apparently has good autofocus. And if it doesn't overheat, that's a big deal. Honestly, that's the biggest thing that I can see out of these two cameras. And that's really sad because, like, look at what Sony and Canon just did.
Right. Yeah, it does have this weird feeling where, like,
wah, wah.
Right. The like, Nikon released the Z6 and 7 a month before the EOS R came out. Mm-hmm. And, like, since then, Canon has come out with three of their mirrorless bodies. And look at the specs of the R5 compared to the Z7. Now, granted, these cameras, I need to get the prices in front of me. I believe the Z7II is $3,000, so it's less than the R5, which it should be for what you're getting. But what I don't have is the Z6II price point. Z6II, courtesy of B&H Photo. Although apparently the Wi-Fi is not working so great. There it is. Oh wow, it's the Z6II is 1996, so 2000.
The Z7II?
No, the Z6II.
Oh, the Z6II.
Yeah,
so
the Z6II.
The same. It's the same price as the Z6I.
Yeah.
Nice. Yeah.
So that's good.
So you spend $1,000, like a third more, right, and you get the Z7.
They don't have 10-bit internal. That's another thing that it has it external via HDMI out.
That's actually a big deal.
Yeah.
Because Canon does shoot it. I'm pretty sure it overheats in 4K, but it shoots it
internal,
yeah, and it shoots it in 1080 as well. And that's,
yep,
you know, it's going to get. It's just the thing that's remarkable to me is we know that most people that buy the R5, R6, Z6, Z7II, the thing that really matters to them is the stills. You have those outliers that really care about the video specs. And it feels like these camera companies are hitting the video specs because that's what they are being able to move forward right now. But I guess they definitely talked a lot about the autofocus being better on the Mark II Z cameras.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe that's true. That's a reason to upgrade maybe.
Right. Well, yeah, I mean, that to me is like, it's not in the spec list, but the autofocus is supposed to be significantly better.
But it's the same points, same number of points.
Same number of points, yeah.
Just trusting that the extra processing speed makes it better.
Well, I think it would. I mean, you've doubled the processing speed. So, I mean, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it should.
It should. It's, you know, the question of, it's only as good as the algorithms, I suppose.
Right. So
doing a poor algorithm faster doesn't make it better. But I guess we'll have to see. I know that a lot of people have complained about the continuous autofocus on the Z cameras.
Yes.
On YouTube.
Yes.
I don't know that you've had a lot of
The Z7, and you can check out a video where I talk quite a bit about the Z7 on our channel. But I mean, granted, I was using it for landscape shooting, you know, in single shot. I do know that, like, with Sony and Canon, I use continuous all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And with Nikon, I definitely used single shot because the continuous it felt a little quirky. Quirky is the right word. So, and that seems, I mean, they're saying they've ironed that out, but they've also said they've ironed that out in several of their firmware updates, and it's been hit or miss. So
sounds a little like something Panasonic likes to do.
Yeah, with their autofocus.
With their autofocus, and they do make it better every time, but it's not
right.
There's that line between reliable and unreliable.
Right,
and that's the line you want to cross. That line might be 3% better than it is right now.
Right.
But if it's 10% worse and you improve it by 3%, it's still unreliable.
Right.
And in general, you'll end up jumping to the thing you can rely on.
Right.
And the funny thing is, I think it's easy to talk about, it's easy to blame Canon for putting in the record limit kind of on the overheating. Once again, going back to that, it's a big story we've been talking, that's been kind of circling around the camera industry a lot.
Right.
But I think that idea of when you see the number of minutes when you hit record, you will be able to record for that many minutes.
Right.
So it's that level of reliable.
Right.
And that, I think that's why Canon made that decision. It's because they want you to be able to predict what your camera is going to do. So if you can't predict what the autofocus is going to do, can't predict when the camera is going to overheat, like from Sony, like you just didn't know, even if the alert came up, who knows when it's actually going to die.
Right.
That's a hard balance to walk, pushing things forward and providing new kind of untested specs. And you saw how Canon chose to do that. But with these cameras, if the autofocus is great with the Z6II and the Z7II, I honestly think there's a chance that they are some of the best well-rounded cameras, best value for money, maybe right this second.
Right this second. But I don't think that this second is going to last that long. I don't think people are switching to Nikon over these cameras.
Well, no, and the lenses are the biggest issue probably.
And the lenses are like, the Z lenses are great, but their roadmap is going really slowly. Well, 2020 hasn't gone well for anybody, right?
No.
But still, over the course of 2020, you look at what Canon's been able to actually get out lens-wise, and then you look at what Nikon's actually been able to get out, and it's really sad. Mm-hmm. If you just look at the R system from Canon, and then you compare it, you're like, wow, this system is way ahead. Like, the R system is ready for a pro to move into it,
with the exception for those
sports super and tellies. Yeah, super tellies and sports and wildlife and all that.
They have EF.
And Nikon, like, they have the 14 to 24 2.8 announced, but who knows when it's actually coming. So
indeed.
Well, that is about all the time we have for today. So we hope you enjoyed this little video podcast or audio podcast, depending on how you're consuming it. And where the plan is to do these about once a week. Mm-hmm. You're look for a Thursday, Friday release. That's what we're hoping for. We're not absolutely committing across the board, but that's what we're hoping to do and kind of various topics. So if there is something you would like us to talk about, next week, you should comment it down below. If you have any questions for us if you have a question for me about the R5 or Toby about the R5, he's shot more video with it than I have. So
yes, it's weird to be like all these people out there thinking, if I only had an R5, I could just try it out. It's like, one fell into my lap by accident.
Just tried it out.
and I got to try it out, but if you have any questions about stuff or even on our other videos, if you saw a different video and had a question.
Right, and had a question, for
about
sure.
A tool we're using, or if we like something, or really anything.
Right, yeah, really, really anything. We'll probably talk about it. And on our channel, we have a lot of gear related videos. We also have a lot of videos where we, get out into the mountains and use that gear. So, that's the summit bid part of all this. So
yeah, definitely go check it out. We released a couple of videos. Maybe next week we'll talk a little bit about the GoPro Hero 9. We've used that on a few trips and released some videos on it. So you can check those out.
Yeah.
We'll link to those two videos on the YouTube channel at the end of this or in the show notes, I guess.
Yeah. Cool.
If you want to check them out, Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you so much for listening, and we'll see you next time.
Indeed. Bye.